Hi students, as I have told you that in the next video I will start the characteristic of romantic poetry, romantic age especially. So let us start. You know that romantic poetry was the reaction against the neoclassical age. The kind of concepts which were there followed by the poets, by the essayists, by the dramatists of a neoclassical age. So this romantic age is totally against them. So we can say that all the things which were in 18th century, it were opposed by romantic literary artists like William Wordsworth, like S.T. Coleridge, like John Keats, like P.B. Shelley, in the essays Hazlitt, in the essays Charles Lamb, they all have. So, students, romantic poetry's first characteristic that it has a strong message that this poetry, what we are going to serve, this is unlike the poetry of a neoclassical age. Neoclassical poetry, neoclassical literature, which have some certain bondings, some certain limitations. They have just confined themselves into the narrow range of classicism only. They have set certain fundamentals and they cannot go against it. They have confined themselves only in the range of aristocratic society, only on the higher class of society. So this age, this is the first quality, students, you must have in your mind, that the literary artist, whether this is poets or essays, they have made themselves free from the bondage of 18th century and made reaction against this 18th century neoclassical age, and they have made themselves free to select the subject freely, and this subject can be the subjects of common life, the natural atmosphere, the nature scenery, and the concerns of common men. So this is the first quality of romantic poetry, that romantic age, this is romantic literature, it is, you can say that this is the quality of romantic age, ki it is reaction, it is a reaction against the literature of 18th century neoclassical age. Now the second quality is this return to nature. The literary artist of this period had a strong interest in nature. Their subject matter is nature. If we take the example of William Wordsworth, he is called the worshipper of nature. De Quincey was a great critic of this 19th century, he has said that William Wordsworth is a great worshipper of nature. Means for them, nature is the main thing. The subject matter is nature. Whatever thought they personally have, so they present them through the description of nature. And in the literature of especially William Wordsworth, you know, that four segments of nature he had just made there in his literature. First, that nature gives you pleasure with its physical appearance, the first step. And to the second step, William Wordsworth says that in nature, in the lap of nature, you will find some peace. There is a peace and consolation. Relaxness is there in the nature. And thirdly, he says that a divine presence is in the nature, in the birds, in the rivers, in the mountains. He says that I am watching some divine power, some divine spirit in it. And you know, here I want to add, here I want to give you clear that a man who believes that in every object of nature, some presence of God is there, some presence of divine spirit is there. So they are called pantheist, and this concept, this belief, this literary theory is called pantheism. In every object of nature, presence of God is there, right? William Wordsworth, you have just studied, I have taught you. There is famous line in his poem, "A presence that disturbed me with joy." Means he watched some presence there. And not only William Wordsworth, other poets of this generation, like S.T. Coleridge. S.T. Coleridge has seen supernatural elements in the nature. His supernatural elements are different. And P.B. Shelley is also watching some divine spirit in the nature. When you study Ode to the West Wind, you will find that some spirit is there. And in the poem of John Keats, you will find the same kind of quality for him also. Even in the birds, you know, even in nightingale, in skylark, the romantics was some divine spirit. So this is the effect of Rousseau's philosophy, return to nature. So all the romantic poets has made nature their best subject. Students, you must have in your mind, this is also against the neoclassical poetry, because in neoclassical poetry, nature was not the concern of the literary artist. Artificial life, the pomp and show, only the sofa, only the excellent chairs, only the bedrooms, only the palaces are the concerns of only the decoration of body, only pomp and show, decoration, fashion. This was the concern of neoclassical writing, neoclassical literature. But here, all the writers, all the literary artists, especially the poets and essayists, they have just set themselves just in the range of nature. This is the second quality, that they have made themselves in the area of nature. The nature is the prime subject of this. And I think we have started that the third point, the third standard, what William Wordsworth has said, that it has some divine spirit. Now the fourth thing, what William Wordsworth says, that nature is a teacher. Don't go anywhere else to read anything, to study anything. Take the shelter of nature. Be in the lap of nature. This is a teacher. It can teach you all the lessons of life. And especially if you study the Lucy poems of William Wordsworth, especially the poem Education of Nature, it is started that 3 years she grew in sun and shower, then nature called her lovelier flower. And it's a title, Education of Nature. Means Lucy has got all the teachings, all the education from nature. And that's why I will wait for her, and I will make her lady of my own. She will be my darling. William Wordsworth has written. Students, if a child grows, if a child grows in a common family, so he studies hate, hatred, jealousy. But if you are in the lap of nature, so you studies only sympathies, only love, only selflessness. Students, you have studied in Hindi, वृक्ष कबहु नहीं फल भखय, नदी न संचय नीर, परमारथ के कारणे साधुन धरा शरीर. Means nature gives you the education. You can study in very same poem, what about I am just delivering you in Education of Nature. Lucy was just taught by the below bend, that you call sarpat, below bend. they have just in this form, means they just bow their head. So Lucy will understand the humbleness by the below bend. And even the fawn running on the hills, in river areas, in valleys, they will teach my Lucy the lessons of life. And William Wordsworth, the concern of William Wordsworth, that the lap of nature can give you the best teaching of life. You know, that the teachings of 18th century literature, the artificial literature, it will give you definitely the frustration, the tension in your mind, only the restlessness. But if you are the student of nature, only nature can give you the solution of all your problems. But unfortunately, we are struggling. And students, you can understand that French Revolution was seen by William Wordsworth. The struggle he has seen, the restlessness he has seen in the society, how the men are going against the empire. He thought that why this is happening so. It's a major reason is this, that men are emotionless. They are away from nature. And if you study his great poem, The World Is Too Much With Us, he says there, that world is too much with us. We lay waste our powers only in getting and spending. Little we see nature, that is ours. He says that we are involving ourselves only in earning money. We have involved ourselves only in physical pleasure, in the luxuries. What will the result of this? Definitely the frustration, the restlessness, the anarchy, exploitation will be in the society. That's why William Wordsworth says that, come in the lap of nature. This is a healing balm. Nature is a healing balm. Any kind of injury in your heart, its a solution is there in the lap of nature. In this way, whether this is Keats, Shelley, Byron, Charles Lamb even, in the Dream Children you study that he describes well the nature when he was at his grandson's home, you know. So there he describes peach, there he describes the garden, the pond. So all these kinds of description are in romantic age, especially in literature. The second thing I have told you, that this is the description of nature. The next important thing is, earlier in 18th century, you know, that the city life was the subject of literature. Literary artists were just describing city life, the glamour of city life, the pomp and show of city life. But here in Romantics, they have selected village areas. They have just selected the life of villages. William Wordsworth says that cities are created by men. Men created cities. But villages are created by God. God has created villages. And he has sent us in villages. And we have created cities. So, jiski rachana itni sundar, wo kitna sundar hoga? Means, the men of village are more beautiful internally. That's why he has said that now the prime concerns of romantic poetry should be the life of a village life, the country life. Emotional men are there in villages. There is a great poet in Urdu, I think I am missing the name. He has written, Dard ke ahsaas ko shero shukhan tak le chalo. Dhoop ke ahsaas ko shero shukhan tak le chalo. Ya adab ko muflisso ki anjuman tak le chalo. Jo ghazal maasook ke jalmo se waakif ho chali, ab usse bewa ke maathe ki shikan tak le chalo. स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ पोएट्री शुड बी द कंसर्न्स ऑफ विलेज लाइफ. पोएट्री शुड बी इन द लैंग्वेज ऑफ कॉमन मैन हु आर इमोशनल. देयर इमोशंस, देयर पैशंस, देयर पर्सनल लाइफ शुड बी डिस्क्राइब्ड इन द पोएट्री. स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ तो दिस इज ऑल्सो अगेंस्ट 18th सेंचुरी नियो क्लासिकल, कि नियो क्लासिकल पोएट्री वॉज, नियो क्लासिकल लिटरेचर वॉज कंसर्निंग ओनली ओवर द सिटी लाइफ, बट हियर द कंट्री लाइफ. एंड इन रोमांटिक पोएट्री द डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ द रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ कॉमन लाइफ इज देयर. नेक्स्ट इंपॉर्टेंट क्वालिटी, कॉमन लाइफ इज डिस्क्रिप्टेड. द मैन ऑफ हट, द मैन लिविंग इन forests, the description of tribes, the description of hearth, the description of village, the description of men working in the fields, the beautiful girls of not aristocratic society, the beautiful girls not like Belinda, beautiful girls like the girls who has been described in Solitary Reaper by William Wordsworth, who is there busy in harvesting in the field, very happy sees, right? So these kinds of the common life, not the life of aristocrats, not the life of cities is described in Romantic Age, but the life of common men was just described in the creations of romantic artists. Next important quality of Romantic Age is simplicity, not a glamour which was there in 18th century. Glamour was the concern, glamour was the subject matter. The description of Belinda by Alexander Pope you have seen, yes. What kind of pomp and show she had. William Wordsworth and his generation, this generation of romantics denied that this must not be concerns. If we are talking about fraternity, liberty and equality in the society, so why should be the subject matter of palaces should be in literature? Only simple things, common things of common life must be the subject matter of the literature. That's why this is the next important quality, simplicity. Now, and the next important quality, that spontaneousness should be there. Means you must not prepare yourself for the composition. You must not select some special subject. You must not request Arabella Farmer like Alexander Pope, ki may I write the poem. A spontaneity should be there. Whatever is coming in your heart, spontaneously you should write, you should add in your literature. As William Wordsworth has given his definition of poetry in his preface to Lyrical Ballads, the critical the literature of criticism, what he has produced in earlier videos I have just taught you. He has given a nice definition. Poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. Means spontaneously, when emotions just come in your heart without any pressure, if you are watching something, a kind of emotion just comes in your heart, and if that emotion is love-like, a strong emotion, it is converted into the form of poetry. But here I want to add you students, because I have described the criticism of William Wordsworth, that William Wordsworth thought, when he has said that poetry is the spontaneous overflow of power, he thought that only emotions cannot create poetry, we should add something more. So then in a next part of the definition of poetry, he has added that not only poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feeling, but it takes its origin from the emotions recollected in tranquility. Means when you watch something, when you see something, and by watching this, you come in the impression of some emotion. So this is not necessary that start writing at that very moment. You cannot write composition because at that time your emotions are in excited position. You cannot write poem at that time. When you get relaxed in your bedroom or anywhere in the lap of nature, when you are in tranquil mood, relaxed mood, so those emotions are recollected in your mind. And when your matters are recollected, so with those emotions, your thoughts are also included. When this mixture, what earlier only in the form of emotion, when with those emotions, the appropriate thoughts are added, then it comes a poetry. Then it becomes poetry. This is the genesis of poetry. This is the process of poetry. That first emotion comes, then in tranquil mood, you recall it. This is collected in your mind, and finally, its description starts. And its expression starts in the form of poetry. Students, if you study Muktibodh in Hindi, then he says that bhavatmak vichar and vicharatmak bhav. Muktibodh, Hindi critic and poet, he says that without emotion, thought is useless, and without thought, your emotion cannot just express your inner urge. Students, you must have in your mind all these things. So William Wordsworth says that this simplicity, this spontaneity should be there in romantic poetry. So this thing has been followed by most of the literary artists of this age. Next important thing is humanitarianism. Means human, man should be the concern of the poetry, not superman. Man means common man of the society, should be the subject matter. The solitary reaper should be the subject matter. The hermits sitting in the cottages in the forest should be the subject matter. Common things, the human life, the struggling human life, what kind of struggle is there in the life of common man? That should be, as I have told you, the sher. Yes, it was the sher of Adam Gundvi again. I am just reminding you. Dhoop ke ehsaas ko sher o sukhan tak le chalo, ya adab ko muflison ki anjuman tak le chalo, jo ghazal maasook ke jalmon se waakif ho chali, ab use bewa ke maathe ki shikan tak le chalo. So these kinds of concerns should be there in literature. This was the effort of 19th century romantics, students. Now, for the diction and style, William Wordsworth says that lyricism should be there in the poetry. It should be lyrical. It must have lyricism. And that's why the most of the literary artists like William Wordsworth and S.T. Coleridge, they have included so many meters. Like anapaest, dactyl, iambus, iambic, all the meters they have used, and especially in diction, he says that poetry should be the language of common man. It must not be the difficult language, the classical language. It must not be the classical language. We are not writing the composition, not poem, for higher class of society only. We are, poet is not for poets. Poet is writing for common man. He is also a common man. Poet is not superman, William Wordsworth says. So his language, his style should be the language and style of common man. The language which is used by common man, that should be the language of man. That should be the language of poetry. This is the important thing what the romantics has just given. Next important thing is subjectivity. Subjectivity. Subjectivity means personal life. Means your approach should be subjective. Means what your personal thought is there, your personal personality is there, what your personal thought is there, that should be in the poem. You must not like Francis Bacon. You should like William Wordsworth. You should like Charles Lamb. I, we, these are the words often used in literature of romanticism, romantic poetry. Their personal life is described there. If you study P.B. Shelley, oh world, oh life, oh time, I fall on the bleed of time, I fall on the thorn of life, I bleed. So I, we, these kinds of words are there, means subjectivity is there, personal life, autobiographicality is there in the romantic era's literature, in the literature of romantic age. This is very important thing. Next important thing, that imagination and sensibility. Imagination is one of the most important quality. In the beginning of this video, I have told you that imagination means on the imagination is a kind of creativity. Means by the imagination you create something. This is the creation of mind. A man who is not imaginative, he cannot be a poet. He cannot be a creative man. Very important thing that you should be creative. And when you are creative, this is because of only your imagination. And on this power of imagination, the employment of imagination in the poems, all the romantic poets are the best poets. And they have nice composition. If you study John Keats, his power of imagination very nice. In his great poem, Ode to the Grecian Urn. What kind of nice description he has made. What those meadows are there, what those leaves and plants are there, on that Grecian Urn. What kind of nice imagination is there? The description, someone is just playing the flute, and that part we can never forget. On what we emphasize, the incomplete kiss, the description of incomplete kiss. Nobody can forget what a nice description he has made. And by this description, he has tried to present the universalness of the beauty. The permanency of the beauty. This description of beauty is also most important characteristic of romantic poetry. Whether this is the beauty of man, whether this is the beauty of nature, and whether the beauty of terrible things in Walter Scott. Description of terrible beauty of nature is also there. The beauty has always been the prime concern of romantic literature. And here, not only John Keats, but the power of imagination. You can understand in the Rime of Ancient Mariner by S.T. Coleridge. Water, water everywhere, all the board did string. Water, water everywhere, not a drop to drink. Students, what a power of imagination he has. And if you read Tintern Abbey by William Wordsworth, as I have told you already, the description of Lucy in Lucy poems, especially Education of Nature, what a nice imagination power they have. By the power of imagination, they have created a livingness, a special kind of beauty, what just attracts the readers towards. These are the major qualities. Some other qualities are also there in romantic poetry and romantic age. So I will just discuss it in the next video, because this video is also going to be long. So dear students, wait for the next video. Thank you.